I am really excited to welcome you all to the 19th annual Milken Institute Global Conference. I'm delighted that you've joined us for what we know is going to be an exciting, thought-provoking, and certainly a busy 3 days. There are over 200 sessions, more than 750 speakers. The schedule is packed as you know it, so let's get right to it. This is our kind of morning introduction to the power of innovation. And this opening panel, Sustaining the New Golden Age of Medical Research, it really brings together an awesome group of visionary leaders in biomedical research. These are some of the smartest, most accomplished, and I would add particularly most dedicated people that you will find in the biomedical and healthcare space. You can read their full bios in the conference app, MI Global, which we urge you to download if you haven't already. So, this panel, it's been an interesting one for me to help to organize. So I lead FasterCures. We're a center of the Milken Institute. We were started over 13 years ago by our founder, Mike Milken, to my left. And our goal is to really look at the system and see, can it be more efficient? Can we drive to the finish line that much faster? Because as we like to say, patients are waiting. And I think what you're going to hear today is kind of a representative sample of some of the opportunities that the system is offering us today and some of the challenges. So we're going to go through a real fast and furious ride about that system. And people are going to, I think, bring their very personal perspectives. As we prepared for the panel, I had the opportunity to get a chance to speak to all of the panelists about some of their own personal journeys. I learned lots of interesting things. One of them that I kept asking over and over, really, is that Congressman Yoder, all the way down on the left, doesn't drink coffee. And so he is extra alert today on the power of just his excitement about biomedical research. You know, I don't have a great little vignette for each of you, but one thing I want to say about Mike is his excitement and enthusiasm for this area is matched by his excitement for his wife. And if you haven't seen the Forbes piece that has a picture of your office, Mike, there is a lovely picture of Mike and Lori in it from college days. That shows, you know, sort of a very young and inspired Mike Milken about to change the world. So I want to get started with some very kind of top-line thoughts on this golden age of biomedical research. And I've gone back and forth, and my panelists were saying, who are you calling on first? So it's a bit of a surprise for them. So, Kathy, I am going to start with you first. I want you, if you can, tell us in a moment about your personal journey. How did you get here? And what are you excited about? We are going to take the panel through this journey of the excitement, but also the system challenges that we face. So, Kathy, if you could do a quick sort of bio of yourself and how you ended up on this panel, we would love to hear that.
Okay. So I was working in the pharmaceutical industry at first with Merck and then with Searle. And at 37, I was diagnosed with multiple myeloma, which is a blood cancer similar to leukemia and lymphoma, and at the time told that I would be dead within 3 years. Unfortunately, with multiple myeloma, back when I was diagnosed in 1996, it was very black and white. It was no gray area. There were no drugs in the pipeline. There was nobody working on the disease, and there was absolutely no hope. So I decided to take my pharmaceutical background and start the Multiple Myeloma Research Foundation, and fast forward 20 years later, nearly 20 years later now, and I think multiple myeloma has probably seen the greatest advancements of almost any cancer. We've had 10 drugs approved, 4 just last year. 2 of them were antibodies. We have tripled the lifespan of the patients that we serve. We've sequenced our genome, and we have been very fortunate to build an amazing community of scientists, community folks, the pharmaceutical companies, biotechs, payers, and we've been able to get our arms around our ecosystem in order to allow us to drive precision medicine forward much faster than probably anybody else can do it right now.
Fantastic. Thank you. Elias, I'd love to turn to you next to talk about it from your perspective. You mentioned yesterday in a panel discussion that you came to the U.S. What brought you here, and how have you landed on this panel?
Well, first of all, I think the U.S. in the time I came here was an extraordinary magnet for talent around the world. It was the only country where you could really, as a young and scientist, I was a mathematician and physicist, and I was interested in medicine. I was very interested in computerized imaging. It was the real thing at the time. And you couldn't do it anywhere else. I mean, it was only in the U.S., so I had a three-month scholarship. I came to Hopkins, and I had this idea that you could use CAT scanners to measure calcium in human tissues. And I talked to my professor at the time, and I explained to him all the algorithms. And you can imagine now talking about technology and computing and algorithms in the mid-'70s, late-'70s at Johns Hopkins with my professor, who was a traditional professor. And he said, you know, son, I don't understand a thing about what you're talking about, but I'll give you 3 months in the lab, try it. This try it at a young age, I was 25 years old, is extraordinarily powerful. And one of the things I will say is that I've been very lucky. I went to Hopkins, I studied imaging, molecular imaging, cell imaging, body imaging, and then I went to the NIH. I was given that opportunity, now I'm given the opportunity to develop drugs, so I have a great perspective now on the whole system. But the one thing I would never forget is that today, with the funding at NIH the way it is, a young investigator will not get his first grant till age 42. 95% of scientists have made their contributions by that age. And so I think one of the major block of the system that I think we need to worry about is the next generation of scientists, because in my view, I think the process of discovering new therapies has changed. If we do it the way we did it 30 years ago, we'll still be at it 100 years from now. So there is a transformation that needs to happen, but it won't happen without a new generation of very different-minded new scientists.
Thank you very much. And I want to get back to that transformation, certainly in this panel. Congressman Yoder, how did you land on this panel, and how did you decide that you wanted to run to be a member of Congress?
I'm still asking myself that question, actually. no, it's nice to be with everyone here. You know, I'm from Kansas, grew up on a farm, and was in the state legislature, ended up running for Congress in 2010, and come at a time in which we are very divided, in which the those divisions make it difficult for us to tackle large problems such as balancing the federal budget or reforming the tax code or creating the jobs we need to create in this country. And so, you know, like many of us, we are looking for solutions that, you know, one, we can take back home and tell our constituents we're getting something done on our behalf. You know, but the other thing is, for many of us, I fly back and forth every week. So I live in the suburbs of Kansas City. I have little children, and you know, I fly up on a Monday, come back on a Thursday. You're raising lots of money, you're campaigning a lot, and you want to ultimately be able to say, was this worth the time? What sort of impact did we make? What would I tell my children someday we accomplished something on their behalf? And so as we sift through our agenda and try to reprioritize and find things that are really important, I kept coming back to the issue of medical research, particularly support for the NIH, and weighing it against other things. And how do you ultimately come up with something that's more important than curing cancer or, you know, treating someone with an incurable disease? And so those issues have been very compelling for me. I have a 2-year-old daughter and a 6-month-old daughter. And as I look at the national debt, a lot of it, it's hard to explain to them where it went. But if we borrow money to cure disease, I think someday, if we, for example, borrowed billions of dollars and we cured cancer, so their generation never had to live with what many of us, families and friends and colleagues have had to live with, and they were a generation that was cancer-free, I think they would thank us for borrowing money in their name to do it. And so that's kind of what drives me. And it's been part of our effort in Congress to renew our support for NIH research.
Congressman, when we spoke, you talked about an analogy to if there had been a terrorist attack and we suffered a loss of life due to that, and you made a link to some of the disease burden. Can you elaborate on that?
Sure. You know, statistics will tell us that 600,000 people will die of cancer this year, and if you think about if 600,000 people died of a terrorist attack in the United States this year, we would be on red alert. Everyone would be talking about it. We'd be harnessing every dollar possible. It wouldn't even be a question. No one would say, well, what's it cost? We would say, 600,000 people are going to die. What other question do you need? That's clearly a mandate to do whatever it takes to stop that. And yet it goes on and on every year. And that's just one disease. And so I think looking at this from, in my perspective as a Republican, how do we, you know, shore this up with our philosophy of limited government, of less role of the federal government in particular? And the pitch I've made to my colleagues is this is similar to national security. You know, we're spending, say, $700 billion this year on national defense. And the purpose of that is to protect and keep Americans safe. Yet we're going to spend just over $30 billion trying to find a cure for every disease, of which the human death toll and impact will be far, far, far greater. And so looking at this in a national security way is a way I've partially framed it to my very conservative colleagues to help them think about the impact and what we're really trying to do. And a lot of them have said, well, why can't private industry do this? Why can't local government do this? And it isn't one of those things where you can say, well, my city council is going to cure cancer or my local school board is going to handle this. This is something that is a unique federal priority, just like national defense. And so looking at it that way has been, I think, one of the compelling reasons we've received congressional movement on this issue.
Well, and one of the things at FasterCures that we have pointed out over the years is that there is an ecosystem, and what you see represented on this panel, these folks are really representing that ecosystem. So to your point, Congressman, just like private industry couldn't do it alone, we also need venture philanthropy, the types of groups like Kathy created, Mike, your Prostate Cancer Foundation. You know, now increasingly, we're not going to talk about it in this panel, but there is a panel later on this topic, the payers, how are we actually going to pay for the innovation? So it's a complex and diverse system, but Francis, you participated with us yesterday in a panel that included both discussions of biomedical, but also financial systems. And I think for Francis, Mike, it was a moment of maybe an epiphany of maybe biomedical is not the most complex system on the planet as we all like to think it is. You know, financial regulations are also intricate and perhaps in areas cumbersome. So Francis, you know, I know everything about your past because I have moderated you on numerous panels. So I could bring up lots of things about your journey to this panel, but I want you to pick some highlights. I mean, Elias gave us, I thought, a really nice moment of understanding, you know, Elias, you as a 25-year-old, you know, having the excitement about science. Francis, how did you end up doing what you're doing?
Well, it's a privilege to be on this panel with such other distinguished voices. And as Elias was speaking, I was certainly reflecting on my own experience. I was first hired as a real job at the University of Michigan at the age of 34, and I had my first NIH grant actually awarded about a month before I arrived there because I wrote it while I was a postdoc. I had already gotten a PhD in, of all things, physical chemistry and then went to medical school, a very sort of odd trajectory. And I wanted to try a very high-risk effort to see if it could be applied to discovering genes for human diseases, things like cystic fibrosis, which were a complete black box at that point. And for that first 3 years, everything I tried didn't seem to be working. I had a failure after failure. I did not publish a single paper in my first 3 years as a faculty member. And yet, I had people who believed that it was worth taking the risk. My chairman, the NIH program person, just keep at it. And ultimately, this succeeded and led to the discovery of things like the CF gene and others. I'm not sure that today a young scientist would be given the chance that I had because of this intense pressure to produce, to get your paper published in Nature, Science, or Cell, any of those journals that have just one word in their name. You know, they're going to be really competitive. And your chairman is all over you, like, okay, you better hurry up and get some publications, or maybe your grant won't get renewed, and then we'll have to pay for you. The atmosphere is really intensely difficult and challenging right now. It's hyper-competitive. We are not benefiting from that. It's good to have competition, for sure. So where is NIH right now? Well, I think we are in a circumstance where the science has never been more exciting than it is today. And I, having lived through this for 3 decades, I can say that with great confidence. The things that we are on the brink of being able to unravel, Some of them in very basic investigations, really understanding how life works in neuroscience, the brain project that's going to figure out how those 86 billion neurons between your ears do what they do, and all those circuits that are involved in amazing functions that we only dimly understand. We're going to figure that out. And then the applications of this, whether it's to cancer with the cancer moonshot, which we'll probably talk about, whether it's the precision medicine approach to trying to identify individual approaches to prevention or treatment. We're on a total roll here. And we do, I think, need to, in order for that to succeed, depend on this ecosystem. And that's been one of my personal goals, is to be sure that we build those collaborations with industry, with philanthropy. And those are all, I think, in reasonable shape, although they could be better, and we'll probably talk about some of the obstacles there in terms of data sharing. But from my perspective, the big barrier that's getting in our way is, in fact, that we're under-resourced. We're not lacking for ideas. We're not lacking for talent. We're scaring away some of the talent, though. Somebody like myself, who's now 34, trying to get their first grant, well, first of all, they're probably not even trying yet because our training program is so prolonged. And then if they did actually manage to do that, they'd face the lowest success rate in history, about 16% of grants getting funded. If I could just quickly put up slide 16, because I think it is a quick way of showing why it is that we're feeling this squeeze. That shows you, if we can project it up, there it is, what's happened to support for biomedical research through the NIH. And the white line is basically adjusted for inflation. So this is basically dollar values adjusted to 2012. You can see between 98 and 2003, there was that wonderful doubling. But then following that, the budget went stagnant, inflation eroded our purchasing power. And then in 2013, there's that unfortunate downturn called the sequester, which took away $1.5 billion in the middle of the fiscal year, from which we have not really quite recovered. So question is, where are we going with this? The dotted yellow line, by the way, is the path that medical research had been on up until 98. If you go back to 1970, there had been this steady growth of about 3.7% real annual growth. If we had just stayed on that, we would be at this point in much better shape. It's because of what's happened in the last 12 years that young scientists in particular are feeling such a squeeze. And I'm very encouraged that in this current fiscal year, the Congress, thank you, Congressman Yoder, and many others, began to turn this corner with a $2 billion increment, a 7% increase. And that has given our field enormous enthusiasm and a sense that maybe we've actually got a chance to get on a stable trajectory. But a big question is, what's going to happen this year and the year after? Medical research is not a sprint. It's a marathon. Almost no project that I can think of that actually had a big impact was done in 1 year. These are things that stretch out, and yet we somehow have to make plans year after year without having any idea what the budget is going to be, and that's pretty stressful. If we had a commitment that this is not just government spending, this is an investment, this builds the economy, this encourages American competitiveness, this actually reduces our healthcare costs from cancer and Alzheimer's because we're going to figure out how not to spend so much money on those diseases. If we could turn that into a plan that was not just a 1 year, maybe we'll do it, maybe we won't, but a trajectory over a decade or more, we could really do something, and we could put America back on the path where we need to be.
Thank you, Francis. So if I were in one of those films when, you know, all of a sudden the actor turns to the camera and says, okay, this is where we are in the story, I would say that so far on this panel, what you've been hearing is the power and the promise of science, right? And this sort of inspirational innovation that is embodied by young scientists who are hungry for the money and need to have the mentorship to stay the course. So we've heard that a little bit from Elias and Francis, and they need the gasoline in the tank. From Kathy, I would say, knowing you, Kathy, what I've heard and what I know is that you were on a course. You were busy living life. You had a young child, and you were dealt a card that you decided to kind of take, pick up, examine, and really forge a different path, not only for yourself, but for all of the patients with myeloma, and I would say much broader than that. Congressman Yoder, you know, you are looking for, you know, an answer to the question that, you know, your children will ask of, you know, what did you accomplish and what were you about? What was important to you? And biomedical research can be one of those issues, solving these complex problems, because as Mike has said eloquently before, if you save one life, you save the world. So Mike, I'd like you to talk about, I know you've got some slides that you might want to add into the mix, but if you could give us a moment about how did you get passionate about biomedical research, not just from the funding standpoint and the promise of young science, but you're a problem solver and you are an innovator in many ways. So how did you end up here?
Well, I was riding my bike when I was 10 years old as the block captain, raising money for the American Cancer Society. I really didn't have that much of association. And then my mother-in-law was diagnosed with breast cancer in 72 and my father with melanoma. And it was an unusual part in history for me in that by 74, we had this financial crisis that I believe is the most important period of time if you're in finance that you need to look at what occurred between 73 and 76. And all my theories that I had developed at both Berkeley and Wharton were being tested in the marketplace. And for me, just like if I was, say, leukemia, I would have gone to Chernobyl to take a look. This was an opportunity to test these theories. And they all, in spite of most people feeling the world was coming to end, it wasn't. And it was a tremendous opportunity to change our financial system for the better during this period of time. And so as this occurred, instead of, let's say, basking in the glory, by 75, my father had melanoma, and I had visited 24 cancer centers, and I had concluded by the early part of 76 that science could not move fast enough along to save my father's life. And this was the first time in my life that I actually had a problem I couldn't solve. And so it really was a wake-up call that I could see the road we were headed down at this time in melanoma and what had to be done in research. So this coincided, I think, I don't just want to step back for one moment here, Margaret, with my belief when you want to solve a problem or address an issue, you need to think about it on a macro basis and then a micro basis. So let's think about it and step back to a macro basis. The largest asset in the world is the productivity of individuals, human capital. People have won Nobel Prizes, Gary Becker the first in 92 for this work, and it is measured in hundreds of trillions of dollars. So if you can improve the quality or the length of life of an individual, you can, a 1% change, if it was, say, worth $500 trillion worldwide, is worth $5 trillion. So when we talk about a rate of return, this is the largest thing the world can do. We can increase human capital. Every mayor, every governor, every senator, every member of Congress, president, and prime minister around the world ultimately is faced with the fact is what is the human capital they're dealing with, whether they're working for the NIH or a company or a country. And so my idea was if we could extend life, reduce pain and suffering, we could dramatically increase human capital. So I think that was my first awakening. Yes, we can develop new financial structures, new financial markets, but if we really want to drive value, we need to deal with human capital. And there was really three ways. One is immigration, but that's moving it around the planet. Two is education, and three is public health, prevention, wellness, treatment, but most important in this equation, research. So that's what led me there. And the amazing thing that has happened, when I look at the chart that Francis put up, it was the 93 to 98 period that we launched what eventually led to something called the March. And Al Gore was the keynote speaker with General Schwarzkopf, myself, and others. And that culminated this five-year effort by thousands of people to double the NIH budget. So that movement that occurred there, the 500,000 people that came together, and Vice President Gore and President Clinton at the time, eventually signing it into law. Now that gave us this impetus to that sharp curve that Francis has shown us there. That has laid the groundwork for this golden age. And I think we need to really step back and understand from a macro basis that more than 50% of all economic growth in the entire world in the last 200 years has come from medical research and public health. So if you want to think about growth, that's what drives growth in an economic sense. And to me, when we study this, the thing, 4 million years of human evolution, 4 million years of evolution resulted in 11-year increase in life expectancy, average life expectancy. And in the last 115 years, we've increased it by 41 years. Now that to me is the major accomplishment of mankind. So that is the macro. Now what else do we know today? What's the micro? I was diagnosed in 93. My mother-in-law passed away from multiple myeloma in 84. My father passed away from melanoma in 79. I lost my first cousins to glioblastoma, et cetera. And when I was diagnosed in 93, I had lost 10 of our close relatives to cancer. And so I, like Kathy, was given a very short life expectancy at that time, 12 to 18 months. So both Kathy and I are very excited to be here today.
Mike, you always say you're the luckiest person in the room because someone told you you won't be in the room in a short period of time.
That is true. And I, when I look back, I went to visit the head of the American Urologic Association. So I knew a lot about multiple myeloma, glioblastoma, melanoma, and other form breast cancer, but I didn't know anything about prostate cancer. And I took my records, and this was March 93, to the president of the American Urologic Association, who headed one of the major universities' cancer efforts. And he looked at it, and he told Lori and I that we should get a psychiatrist for me, a psychologist for the kids, get my affairs in order, and enjoy what little time I had left. That was a very uplifting visit.
Kathy, do you have a similar?
Very similar.
And I think I told him, well, before I do that, I want to try a few things. So, yes, I've been to China with Qi doctors and witch doctors in Africa and Ayurveda doctors in India and healers in Russia and so on. But I would say modern technology has benefited. I have greatly benefited. And this golden age we're talking about today, just imagine our young scientists that we had funded in the 80s. Today, machines are 5 million times faster than the work they could have done. A young scientist doing genetic research like Dr. Jonathan Simon, who heads the Prostate Cancer Foundation at Hopkins at the time, what he could accomplish in 93, a machine can do 5 million times that output today. So we are at this dawn, this $300 billion in incremental investment. We're in the seventh inning here.
And you know I don't know anything about sports, so, you know.
Let's just say, and we're the last quarter.
Okay.
Okay? Think of it as a pie chart. And okay. I think what frustrates Elias is former head of the NIH, and Francis.
And Kathy.
And Kathy, and our congressional leaders, Congressman Yoder, is really that we are on the verge of taking advantage of this unbelievable explosion of technology and this investment, and we have taken our foot off the accelerator.
All right, I want to go now to Kathy to pick up on that point. you know, and then let's spread the conversation around in terms of the promise is unparalleled. How are we going to make sure that we're harnessing that promise?
So I think what you're hearing is that we're all incredibly excited about the science, and I mean, there's never been a better time to be working in healthcare than right now. So everything's booming in genomic sequencing and immunotherapy on the scientific side. But then on the technology side, you're seeing an explosion there too. When you look at everything going into the cloud, digital with electronic health records, EMRs, this is a whole new wave of data that we can all have access to. And then third is, while Mike and I used to be unusual patients, you know, so much advocates in our care, I think with the internet and social media, many patients are realizing in today's world, if you don't get on your game, you are the critical path in research. If we don't get your tissue, your data, if you are not involved, research will absolutely not move forward. So I think the challenge that we face and as we move forward is, how do we find the business leaders? And I don't mean just business. I mean leaders that are in science, technology, and business. And how do we integrate these teams so that we can actually drive progress forward together much, much faster? And what you find is, many of us as leaders, we might have a great scientific background, but we're not sitting there having run a Fortune 500 company, or vice versa. So it's okay. You just have to look at your leadership team and decide how you want to get there. And then as you build out and start to say, where is the unmet medical need in medicine today? Once you define that, especially in precision medicine, that this cancer has this subtype, we can't find the right drug for it, but data and all of us working together will drive it faster, you are de-risking the system, you are encouraging venture to come in, and hopefully we can build a new dichotomy of getting trials done faster and better, companies wanting to come in, diagnostics happening. We've seen it in myeloma. I mean, it was a cancer that every doctor was living in the basement. Nobody ever heard of it. Now we're like the plenaries at the American Society of Hematology, and it's a multi-billion dollar business to be in multiple myeloma today. We are just one pilot, but I think we are a very successful pilot that gives hints of how we move forward together. So one of the things that I'm doing, which I think is an interesting bit of a switch for me, is I do half-time still as founder of the Multiple Myeloma Research Foundation, but my other half-time is now working with Robert Kraft and Jonathan Kraft and working up at Harvard Business School, where the white space of our business is actually bringing together the best leaders in business, science, and technology, small groups, honest, open, transparent discussions. None of this, yeah, and then back in the hallway, that was a stupid idea. We want the discussions actually happening in the room, building out the solutions that come from that and disseminating the real life solutions that we find. So like the first meeting that we're holding in June is with the Prostate Cancer Foundations, ourselves, metastatic breast cancer, but along is coming Genie, Collaborative Cancer Cloud, the PMI from the Obama program, hopefully the Biden group, small groups, let's talk about it openly, honestly. Let's say that I can't get this academic center to share their data with me right now. Am I better off going to the community centers and figuring out a better way to get data? Or am I better off going directly to the patient and finding out how to build better data sets? Or learning from Francis and the PMI, maybe it's nobody's ever going to give you their data set to aggregate it all together, but maybe there are new and federated models whereby we can work together to answer the questions to save patients' lives. And isn't that really why we're all here today? So I'm not giving up, but I think the joy of running a pilot helps us to see firsthand as a patient, I can watch it and I say, just tell me, are you really never going to give us that data? Because if you're not, I have to figure out a way to do it. And let's have the open, honest discussion so we can figure out yet another business model and a new incentive to solve it and keep moving forward.
Do you think we're not being open enough?
We're definitely not being open enough. Every major meeting that I go to that we share information, I walk into the hallway and like maybe somebody was presenting a whole thing on data and you know he shared his analysis and was giving an idea on vaccines. And I walk in the hallway and five scientists will say to me, well, that's bull. We're not doing individual vaccines. And I say, well, why don't you just say that in the meeting? Like in business, we just say it. But we just say it. In science, there's just a very thoughtful approach and you need business leaders to say, wait, you just said this. It is a little bit why I'd like working with the government, by the way, because when I do things like the PMI and working with Francis, that was a six-month program, right? But the government is able to bring in the best people And it really was a well thought out approach of bringing in best in class and being honest in the working groups and continuing those discussions. And I will say, again, I think it was a good combination of a Bray Kathy Hudson, who was a dynamo, she was gonna move it, and Francis, who really was focused on the science. It's the integration of smart people. Money will get us so far. Building leaders and sharing honest information will get us much further, much faster.
But I think what we're also seeing here is that you need this group of committed individuals with vision and passion. And I think, you know, all of us on this panel, Congressman, I certainly don't want to leave you out of the discussion as well. You have to have that vision, passion, force. I think what you're bringing up, Kathy, is it can be tedious and exhausting, particularly if you are, dealing with multiple challenges. So I want to hear about the passion and vision and commitment, Elias and Francis, that you're bringing to the table in terms of the industry perspective and collaboration. Francis, you know, the government perspective, Congressman Yoder, how do you integrate that from a policy standpoint? And Mike, all things. who's up next?
I'll start, but I want to pick up on what Kathy was just saying, because she calls what she's done a pilot. What she and the Multiple Myeloma Research Foundation have done is really a remarkable experience that we've all learned from and are now trying to extrapolate and build upon. And in many ways, what's happening now with the Cancer Moonshot aims to try to take that approach and open it wide open. There is a Blue Ribbon panel right now that's working on the Cancer Moonshot, which just got established about 2 or 3 weeks ago. Which aims, you can put that slide up, as a similar kind of effort to what was done for PMI, to bring together these 28 experts from across the research and advocacy communities to really lay out what should be the scientific goals of this moonshot if it does get funded in FY17, and particularly focusing on such things as data access and openness and sharing, but also a lot of really serious hard science that needs to be done. For instance, in immunotherapy, why do checkpoint inhibitors that work so dramatically for some patients fail in others? We don't really understand that. How could we move from monotherapies to combination trials? How could we begin to get immunotherapy to work for solid tumors like breast and prostate and pancreas, which right now they're not as successful for? Coming back to the PMI, and by the way, that does not stand for private mortgage insurance. I realize we're talking here in a broader audience that has different perspectives. This is the Precision Medicine Initiative, which if you want to pop up that slide to show what it is, I think that would be slide 4, maybe. So basically, this is a bold effort in the United States to launch a program that would enroll 1 million or more volunteers, broadly representing that diversity of our country, but with participants as partners. These are not human subjects. Let me be so clear about that, because that model is so yesterday, and we're not going there. These are people who will be fully engaged in this effort over many years, because this is a longitudinal study. And they will get information back about themselves, and they can decide how much information they want. And this will then allow collection of the largest data set that's ever been attempted, with electronic health record information, with laboratory data, including complete genome sequences, once the costs come down a little bit more, including having people wear all sorts of sensors that detect their environmental exposures and other things that are happening in their body's performance. Imagine that you're a researcher and you have a question. This data is going to be accessible to you as long as you agree to honor the privacy issues, which are going to be really critical here, so that the data remains secure. This is transformative. It will also, by the way, be a wonderful platform for landing all kinds of other clinical trials, whether they be of drugs or devices, because you're going to have 1 million people who are pre-consented, who are excited about taking part in research, and who know they may be approached by other studies who want to be enrolling them. While this is a huge undertaking, and we're just getting it launched this year, and we'll have our 1 million by 2019 is the current plan, it is, I think, going to be a landscape changer of a very significant sort. And many of us are spending a lot of our time on that. But we got to get it right. And that's why having this design effort that Kathy was part of and many others, and now an implementation plan going forward. And interestingly, we just hired the guy who's going to come and run this. And he did not come from academia. He came from Intel. It's Eric Dishman, who's been the manager of their life sciences effort, and brings with that not only his idea about how to get stuff done in a very fast-moving environment and a very informatics-heavy kind of approach, but he's also a cancer survivor who currently has a kidney transplant. So he has that patient perspective in a very personal way. This is going to be a really interesting one to watch.
Francis, let me interrupt here for just one moment.
Please.
Okay, so when I hear 2019, you know, I think of how long it's going to take me to get to Pluto, not how to get a million people. And I think one of the challenges we have today is how do we accelerate? Obviously, that was the concept behind FasterCures. Mm-hmm. So as I remember, Francis, it is now more than 2 months since I had offered you $1 million to kick it off.
Uh-huh.
And in a 24-hour day period, 1 billion people will go to Facebook. 1 billion. Okay.
Well, and on the panel went to Facebook this morning, Kathy and I probably,
or,
right?
Or Instagram, okay, or WhatsApp, etc.
Sure.
So when you say a million, they can't, they wouldn't even be in business if they thought a million. And if you say 3 years, they couldn't even contemplate something that took that long. So yes, you have to build it right. Mm-hmm. And I think this is our challenge that I'd like to give the panel. As I reflect over the, you know, the 45 or so years I've been involved, each one of these things we've been trying to figure out how to accelerate. And Margaret, maybe you should spend a few minutes on partnering for cures by bringing people together. But it only took 2 or 3 months in 93, the people that didn't want to share, we didn't share our money. Okay, they told us their work was too important. We said, we understood. You don't need our funding. You're too important. Your work's too important. You'll get funding. But if you want to share with everyone, you could get funded. Well, within 6 months, everyone decided they wanted to share. So I don't really believe, and if I look at Melanoma Research Alliance, which is the largest funder under Faster Cures, they have 6 or 8 new drugs approved. They're less than 10 years old. They're the world's largest funder. They didn't wait around. So to me, the challenge is most of these problems are going to be solved through machine learning, artificial intelligence, in combination with human beings.
Well, and I want to hear from...
And so all I'm just asking here, are we going to wait for that to happen, or can we find a way to make it happen now?
Congressman, I want to hear really quickly from your perspective. I want to incorporate you into the dialogue. I mean, what are you thinking as you're hearing this conversation about the power of what Francis has described? And Elias, we haven't even gotten to you in terms of the promise of what industry is working on. So what role do you think that Congress plays in this? And do you think this sort of, you know, approach that both Kathy and Mike are putting forward of, you know, get it done now, resonates?
Well, it resonates with me. I would tell you, as a younger member of Congress, nothing's more frustrating than people telling you each and every day that it can't be done, that there's not enough time. I passed a bill on an unrelated subject last week that was unanimously passed in the House, 419 votes in favor, 0 against. And what we were told immediately by the Senate is they don't have time to work it this year. I mean, just do it this morning. What are we doing? So I think there's a lot of frustration that in government in particular, there are so many hoops and problems that have been created with a litany of thoughts and ideas coming out of Congress every year that it's made it cumbersome and difficult for the system to advance. You know, when I hear all my panelists talk about the excitement they have about the promise of research, it breaks my heart to think that we have obstacles in the way that are making it hard to accomplish. And if it's a resource obstacle, we ought to eliminate that immediately. We're talking about real lives, and I think Mike clearly laid out the economic benefits that aren't really talked about as much. You know, we hear from a lot of patient groups. You know, that's what appeals to us, groups that come in. You know, Kathy's personal story, they tell us these things, and I hear from people every day. Those have an impact on us. So that's our heart, but when we talk about the economic issues, you know, then we're certainly, you know, looking at it in a different way, and that also advances our efforts. You know, ultimately, we have a budget crisis in Washington. We have a deficit challenge that has been there for a long time and is in no way projected to be fixed anytime soon. That crowds out our ability to invest in research. And so this is linked to a whole host of other issues. And for me, I have tried to pitch it in a different way to my colleagues on the Republican side, which is, if you look at the cost of Alzheimer's, for example, in 2050, at $1 trillion for our country. So over $1 trillion in, I don't know what our gross domestic product will be, but $1 trillion at that point would be a pretty big chunk of everything we're doing going to one disease. And if we could cure that, what a savings it would be, both for our government, but both across the entire economy. Yet we're spending about $500 million annually trying to find a cure to Alzheimer's when it comes to NIH funding. So $500 million annual investment, $1 trillion, you know, annual cost. You know, I think you could argue you could spend $5 billion or $50 billion and it still wouldn't be enough to avoid the economic expenses that we're going to pay for, not to mention the human toll. And so I guess when I hear, you know, the ideas that Francis has, we're all for it. And I want to make sure that in Congress, we're not doing things that make it harder, and that we're collaborating, you know, with everyone on this panel to move it as fast as possible. And it gets frustrating to, I think, all of us and all of you to watch paint dry, you know, while people are suffering.
So I want to go, Elias.
I just want to follow up for 15 seconds.
Okay.
We're talking about reducing suffering and quality of life. That's priceless. Let's just make a straight economic argument. The productivity of the people that are being diverted to deal with Alzheimer's far exceeds $1 trillion.
But why is it, Mike? So the dollars make sense, right? When you put forward that economic argument, Congressman, you just put forward eloquent statistics. What is holding us back from this? Is this just short-termitis? Is this, you know, I don't want to think about being sick until, you know, God forbid I am sick?
I think one of the areas that's been discussed here is this has to be viewed as an investment, the same as building a superhighway, a bridge, et cetera.
Have we effectively made that argument?
I think we have. We have not had the activity. And I think, I mean, truthfully, I think Francis knows it. Elias knows it. Most of the people involved know it. The U.S. does not have a monopoly here. If you look at, you know, discoveries, we're not alone. And different countries in the world have brought us different things. China has allocated over $300 billion here to bioscience. They fully recognize today that those countries that are the future in bioscience will be the future leaders in the world. In Japan today, and the Deputy Prime Minister was with us yesterday, many of their major manufacturing and industrial or chemical companies are now becoming bioscience companies. Fujifilm is a bioscience company today. So this investment that has been made in the U.S., other countries are picking up on it, and it might not happen here if we don't stay with the commitment and the frustration. I think of a number of people in the House and things not being brought up in the Senate. We have a large number of senators here. Maybe we should talk to them. But I just want to stress that the most valuable companies in the world today, Facebook is 13 years old or however old it is today. It is more valuable than any pharmaceutical company in the world today. It is more valuable than any consumer product company in the world. And so is Google, and so is Apple, and so is Microsoft, and so on and so on. And I think they're not going to wait around.
Right.
They know that just like the 4,000 people that might be with us at the conference this week, that most people will give you their medical data. Mm-hmm. And they'll give it to you digitally, and they'll figure out what to do with it. And if we have surveys for 22 years have shown that if it becomes public through accident or something, if it can help them, their family, or someone else, okay. So we're protecting people against things they don't want to be protected against for the most part today.
But Margaret, I will say, I actually met with Facebook. I went to meet with them, and I said, there's got to be a better way to reach out to the community than the way we're doing it now. And unfortunately, I got absolutely no traction because the first reaction is, well, what the heck is multiple myeloma and why do I care? I think it's a different reaction if I go in with the Prostate Cancer Foundation and the Breast Cancer Foundation and I just tag along. And that is the reality of what happens out there. There are really great models. There are really great ideas. We all have them. And we actually have to look at the best practices and say, what is working, and how do we become more of a unified front? If one cancer can't get Facebook interested, I was going to take you up on your offer to Francis to get a meeting with Sheryl Sandberg, and I will take you up on that. If we should be doing this. We absolutely should be doing this, but maybe we have to do it as a group. Yeah. Francis has his hands tied in some places that we don't, and vice versa. But I think if you can find ways that foundations, industry, and government can partner together. I still, even though I do agree, a million people takes a long time, but the beauty of what the PMI is trying to do is something I know is really hard to do, and that is follow people and get as much information as you can on them genomically, clinically, metabolically, environmentally, but you're doing it over time. Just trying to do this in a data set in myeloma where you follow patients all the way through every relapse, it's a $50 million study that we had to take on as a foundation to get data in the public domain.
And let me just say that, in fact, we will open up the opportunity for all of you and anybody else in the country to join the PMI initiative along about September, October. If we get 10 million people to say, I'm ready to be part of this, that'll be great. But we won't be able to accumulate all the data that we need, particularly some of the laboratory data, overnight, because that's going to be expensive. It's going to take systems. And I guess we do want to be sure that the system is set up so that we don't have a big security breach early on, because that could be pretty lethal to the public's confidence in this. Even though some people are okay about having their electronic health records spill out into the public view, a lot of people would still be pretty worried about that. So I guess, yeah, Mike, what we're trying to do here is to under-promise and over-deliver, and that seems to be a better strategy than the alternative.
All right,
Francis,
Elias,
let me ask you one question. If you said the first million, because we know we're going to protect you, we don't need your name, but if something happens and they find out, we want a waiver. Okay, so we're only taking the first million of people that will give us a waiver. Okay. My guess is within a week we could get you a million people.
What I love about this panel already is the squad mentality has already been initiated. We've got meetings that are being formed. We've got armies that are amassing behind different efforts. Elias, can you give us a couple of minutes on your framing? We talked about this before the panel, and it involves some geology with rocks, pebbles, and sand. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's some systemic challenges that we're kind of touching on here around the edges.
I counted. They were about 10 minutes. I'm going to more than 2 minutes. I'm going to take that. No, it reminds me when I was in training at Hopkins, we predicted in the early 80s that half of all hospital beds in the U.S. by 1992 be occupied by HIV/AIDS patients. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you remember that. It was a prediction that, in fact, echoes what Congressman Yoder is saying. I mean, this was not just one plane crash. It was one plane crash every hour. And at that time, people were saying, well, we're going to be bankrupt if that happens. The same happened with tuberculosis many years before. We had sanatoria with people staying in hospitals. So it's really amazing to me that Congress and the Congressional Budget Office finds that medical cures are a big driver of costs. It's misuse of medical technology that's a big driver of cost. But when you have a real cure, you empty hospital beds, and that's much less expensive. So to go back to today and to the point you're making, to me, having been in academia, having been in government, having been in industry, the one thing I can probably summarize is that the system, as we know it, is what I call a linear sequential system. And what it's serially treating issues. So what happens is NIH funds some grants, they go to academic institutions, you have researchers, they come up with an idea, they have a target, maybe not in myeloma. That gets passed over to publications, the publications get read by scientists in industry, the scientists in industry try to replicate, they can't replicate it 50% of the time. In the meantime, the government spends $30 billion . Industry spends $65 billion every year, twice as much as the NIH. And at the same time, what we realize is that the system, the big blocks are there. I mean, we have big blocks of researchers, big blocks of patient organizations, big blocks of industry and government, but the system doesn't seem to be working. And so I always remembered when I was in my research, one of the problems we had was processing images was very long. So you had the patient sitting there until somebody came up with the idea of parallel processing and gave me the idea of using multiple small computers and having work together at the same time and splitting the work and having it done in parallel. So I think the biggest change that we can promote is the idea that we need to find a way to have parallel processing of what needs to be done to advance and accelerate cures. If you don't parallel process, you won't be faster. Mm-hmm. Now, when you do this, you also realize there are bottlenecks. And one major bottleneck to me is that we've made great progress in understanding biology. We have tools, as you just heard, about a $1,000 genome. We can do a proteome and all the proteomes in your blood and your cells and all things that we need to apply to humans. We apply them to mice, all right. The problem is that we have made progress in biology, understanding the complexity of biology, but not human disease biology. And this is what the PMI is supposed to do, and this is what we all need to do. So one major block of a change in strategy would be, how do we systematically go away from this linear processing, silos one after the other? When I was at Hopkins, departments wouldn't work with each other. When I was at the NIH, one of my biggest contribution and biggest headache was actually to create the roadmap and the common fund so to have people work together. It's a little bit like what Kathy is saying. In patient groups, the same thing is true. I mean, I always use the example, not of Kathy's group, but cystic fibrosis, Bob Beal, and your group then came, and the model is there. Patients have to be at the center because we have to tackle the bottlenecks. So what are the bottlenecks? Better knowledge of human disease biology in humans. That cannot be done by any one company, any one institution, any one group, any one country. It has to be a global effort, okay? The second, I think, is critical, is the fact that we need a pre-competitive space where there's no shenanigans, where we really look at the data that helps a million genomes understood by the scientists, but understood by the community. Why is that? Because I guarantee you that there is so much heterogeneity in every one of us here that today we're talking about type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. 50 years from now, people are going to look at this and say, my God, how stupid were they? I mean, there are probably 50 different types of diabetes. I can tell you, in our laboratory, I'm looking at mechanisms where one drug actually is designed for obese diabetic patients and another one for normal weight diabetic patients. If I had the old idea of saying, no, one drug fits all, I would fail. But what I would like to say, therefore, about this pre-competitive space, it relates also to parallel processing in the regulatory system. You can't have people who play parallel processing and then a regulatory system that says, well, when you're done, come and see me, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't happen. So what I'm saying is that we have all the elements. It's not like we don't have the money spent on this. The success rate is too low. When you fail 95% of the time, I'm head of R&D, and I'm amazed. We fail 95% of the time. Can you wake up every morning and saying, gee whiz, probably the only experience like that is what I heard from Congressman Yoder, where he fails getting his ideas on the floor 95% of the time. Well, I fail 95% of the time coming up with a solution. But I'd like to go to slide number 8 because I wanted to give a shout out to Francis. In 2003, we had an initiative called the Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging Initiative. It made more impact because the industry came together through the NIH Foundation to study exactly what were the early signals of Alzheimer's disease. Because in a disease that lasts 25 years, believe me, there's no way you can develop a drug for a disease that lasts 25 years and satisfy FDA. You have to have what we call biomarkers that tell you whether the patient is doing better or not in a shorter period of time. Well, Francis put together these partnerships called Accelerating Medicine Partnerships, which really brings the pre-competitive space that we need to parallel process all the information available from the millions of patients who are suffering from it, give us as much insight, validated insight, that we can then hopefully get not a 95% failure rate, but maybe a 90%, which would double the productivity of the industry. So I'm long, But I really believe there isn't a tactical solution to this. It's going to be going from the old world of linear processing to the new world of parallel processing of science.
All right, so panelists, do we have the gumption for this? Are we ready for it, Kathy?
Yeah, I think so. I think that what you find is when science is taking off like it is, and we actually know that we can get the data that we want, that we have the scientists there, we need to fund enough to get all these scientists working in the field. I think the second piece you have to look at is, again, coming back to who's doing the work. If we actually want to figure out what to do with the information we're getting from all the sequencing, all the immune markers, and how do these drugs work together, especially in oncology, how do we combine them? You still need an entire team of bioinformatics people. And we have hardly any. I mean, when we put our data set out there, we found out the clinicians were too busy to look at it in academia. They were seeing their patients. The scientists only had a certain amount of time. And I hate to say this, but the turnover was so high in industry, we had to keep going back into our pre-competitive consortium and train the pharma teams on how to use our data. And it wasn't productive. So now what we're trying to do is put the data out there, let any bioinformatic teams take a look at it, start to understand the aberrations we're seeing, and continue driving it to the clinic. We have a great FDA now. They are willing to sit down with us and say, come to us early, show us how you want to combine these drugs, show us that you want to get drugs approved on a phase two trial. If you can put the right patients into that study with a high unmet medical need, we're here to talk to you about it. That is completely different than what we saw before. Add the patients in, raising their hands, and can we please just explain to them, you are the solution. They do not get it. They do not understand that the holdups of seeing a cure in their lifetime are them. They don't get it. They think everything is fine and they're invincible. And then I think the last piece is commercialization, and let's get some money back into the space, because maybe venture and everybody else will realize if we have de-risk and high unmet medical need, it is a home run for getting new ideas into the marketplace. And I think we move all that forward together, and I think people like the ones on this panel that are passionate about this will do it, and you get leaders in a room, in a small, honest, transparent room to talk about it, you'll move fast.
How do you stay optimistic, Kathy?
You know, I stay optimistic because I actually only align, this is terrible, I align myself with people like the group on this panel. I just, you know, if other people are giving me the naysayer, I don't have time. I'm a little bit like Mike in that my identical twin sister now has stage 3 breast cancer. My mother has melanoma. My father died young of kidney cancer. You know, I don't want this to happen to my son and my daughter. And I actually truly believe, and we didn't talk about this today, I truly believe that by studying these diseases, and I know this in myeloma, we can actually prevent them. And I think we're going to start getting close by looking at all this data in these single diseases. And I hope some of us can just serve as a pilot. I'm never going to be a person like Francis or everybody here on the panel that's looking at all diseases except to do what I'm doing with the Kraft family, which is let me bring you together. Let's have the honest discussions. Let's disseminate that information so you don't have to spend your time trying to figure out where Genie, Collaborative Cancer Cloud, the PMI, the Biden program is. We'll do it for you, and we'll bring everybody together so you can stay up to that space.
Margaret,
hang on just a second. I want to ask a personal question, though, Kathy. What milestones have you hit with your kids that you didn't expect to hit?
So I never thought that I would see my daughter to kindergarten. She was 1.5 when she was born, and I've now seen her. She'll be graduating from Boston College in May and then headed on to Harvard Business School. And my son, who I had after I was born, his only dream was to play Division I baseball, and that's why I was late yesterday. Sorry. He was playing for Lafayette College in Pennsylvania. So many milestones, and I have to be honest with you, I'm sure if you're in this room, it's because you actually care about healthcare. And so while we've talked a lot about the problems, I always like to take this opportunity to thank anybody and everybody that works in this space for what you do, because you have saved thousands of lives. I just think we can save millions if we start moving faster.
Fantastic, Mike. Yeah.
Well, first, I think Kathy represents 16 million Americans who are living who've had cancer, who might never have thought their kids were going to see their kids grow up, get married, have grandchildren, et cetera, which is coming, Kathy. When I listen to this conversation, Margaret, I really take a much different view. Science was in many ways ahead of technology. We had ideas of what we wanted to do. We didn't have the technology. Today, in my opinion, technology is ahead of science, and we need to catch up. Uber didn't say, okay, how many taxi medallions can I buy? And maybe we're going to go do this and wait around and try to figure it out. It was 1965 when I had access to the CRISP tapes on financial data as a student at Berkeley. And I could try to figure out, why do the facts that I could access free as a student, and it was maintained by the University of Chicago, why are they totally different than what everyone says about credit? And so I was just an undergrad. Just imagine when we make this medical data available. Every grad student, every PhD, every MD, everyone that has an idea, every person in mathematics, computer science, physics, chemistry. These sets cost hundreds of millions of dollars to create, but when they're created, one of our trustees of FasterCures, Dick Merkin, he didn't wait around. He put up a $3 million prize and said, who's going to be in the hospital? Here's 150,000 people that we insure. And this is what we've paid for, and this is what's happened to them in the last 5 years. Can you tell me who's going to be in the hospital in the next year? Because we can save a lot of money if we could intervene. 32,000 people competed. Teams from all over the world developed algorithms that were far better than anyone had ever been in predicting who's going to be. Now, they were mathematicians and computer science, hedge fund managers, and a whole bunch of others. Less than half of the people were involved in healthcare. So when I see this, I see, okay, let's get the data. What I'm sure of in 2050 is that the AI, the computers will tell us what we should do when we give them enough data. The fastest computer now can do tens of trillions of calculations a second. Just imagine, tens of trillions of, you can chew through eventually a file a trillion by a trillion. So we are bridging the gap here, and I think what Francis is doing and what is, let's get the data out there, and we don't know whether it's a person in Poland because they've won a few programming Olympics or some other country in the world that's going to come up with a theory, but we need to get that data.
Elias. Mike, I completely agree, and I think it's really the right direction. I think it's happening at grand speed because not just in the U.S., in Europe as well, the IMI is doing this. But there's one bottleneck that you can't overcome. If you cannot overcome it, we will still be going at a very slow pace, and that is patient participation in clinical trials. Mm-hmm. Less than 1.5% of patients with Parkinson's participate. The highest rate is in cancer, 5 to 6%. Now, when you look at the combination therapies that could be defined, when you look at sequencing of tumors, trying to find the subsets of tumor, how are you going to test that unless you have patients who are willing to participate? So we can do all of the calculations, which are important. They're going to identify the patients that are most likely to succeed, like I said, to benefit, like I said, for the obese diabetic patient. But at some point, we need to have a almost like a social movement that says that we will test these novel therapies, and you can't do it at the speed you want if you do it serially with 5% participation.
And that that might be the social movement you end up seeing on something like Facebook's. Patients follow people they believe in. If you were, you know, a prostate cancer patient, you'd probably want to know, what did Mike do? If you're following a blood cancer, you might want to know, what is Kathy going to do? Is she going to put her data into the Obama PMI? Like,
well, you experienced that, right? I mean, every myeloma patient I've ever known has talked to you.
Right.
You know, look at the ice bucket challenge, right? We were all dumping ice on our head and, you know, potentially donating money to this. So I think you're right in terms of the movement of the crowds.
There needs to be a movement. Like I said, I think patients understand that they need to be part of it, but they really don't. It's the moment you say genomics to a patient, it's hard. It overwhelms them. But if we can make such a simple statement and show them what other people they believe in, it could be, you know, even people that are prominent, celebrity, whatever it may be, but that just creates a movement that says you are on the critical path to a cure. It's you and your family.
If we could just double the number of participants, we will double the rate of success.
All right. There's a really good chance to see that happen, and social media is helping with that. You know, the MATCH trial that the Cancer Institute initiated last summer, this is where you have anybody with cancer of various types where the cancer is analyzed for what genetic changes are in that tumor that's driving it, and then you're assigned, therefore, to a targeted therapy based upon your individual findings. Mm-hmm. That trial exceeded all previous trials in terms of the speed of enrollment. In fact, they were overwhelmed and had to actually put pause after a couple of months because they couldn't keep up with all the tumors that were being sent in and needed to have the genome analysis done. They're opened up again now with an expectation of higher throughput. I think we have turned a corner here, and a lot of it is due to organizations like yours, Kathy, and to getting the social media engaged in this mm-hmm. process so that people know about it. Because, you know, why do only 5 or 6% of adults participate in cancer trials? Most of them never heard that they could.
Right.
So their docs don't tell them because the doc is afraid they're going to lose the patient.
Right.
The organizations that might reach out often don't touch the lives of people who most need to be touched. Right. Social media can change that.
Elias talked about a no shenanigans sort of world. Do you think that we can enter into that? Are you feeling that in terms of the various parts of the ecosystem being able to talk frankly? I mean, what Kathy was bringing up as well?
I think so. I mean, there'll always be a fringe of shenanigans, but I don't think it's going to be the mainstream behavior anymore. People won't tolerate it. I've worked as a medical researcher for most of my career. I've rarely encountered somebody who, if you really held them to it and asked them, why are you doing what you're doing, who wouldn't say, yeah, because I want to help people. And if what we're doing is getting in the way of that, how could you possibly defend it? But we need to develop those structures that encourage good behavior and discourage bad behavior, and we've talked about a few of those. I appreciate Elias mentioning the Accelerating Medicines Partnership as a way we can bring public and private sectors together. We're trying to establish something like that for cancer right now that would work in both the basic immunotherapy arena and also in combination clinical trials where no single company has all the drugs and you want to try to see how to put them together. The PMI is definitely trying to establish an infrastructure. And I can tell you as NIH director and speaking from all the rest of those institutes, we are absolutely convinced that open data access is the way that we need to go. And our money is going to get spent with that as an expectation. If you're going to get a grant from us, there is going to be a consequence. We can't necessarily herd the cats, but we can move their food.
So do you feel like you have to put Teflon in the morning sometimes to deal with some of the changes that you're trying to bring along?
Well, there's always going to be people who are unhappy. Change is not always something people embrace. I think all of us on this panel have experienced that. But what is it that Elias used to say? You know you're over the target when you start to have the flak coming at you. So when there's a little flak, that probably means you're on the right path.
So Congressman Yoder, I'm going to give you the opportunity to ask for me to ask you if we're going to see no shenanigans on biomedical research in Congress. I won't ask you to opine on the broader political system. There's other panels doing that.
We originated shenanigans in Congress, so we know all about that.
Can we convert them to good?
Yeah, I think we can. And, you know, we've heard a lot of optimism this morning. We've also heard of some of the obstacles. And my job and other policymakers' jobs is to create a national conversation about these issues. You know, our presidential candidates should be talking about these things. We need leaders in Washington to help make this a national issue. I don't hear from rank and file constituents on a daily basis about this stuff. If you're not in a patient group, if you're not for a research hospital or a company, they're not talking to members of Congress about this. So there's a lot of opportunity here. Our job is to collectively get this on the agenda of our respective members of Congress and get them to lead and take this out to their districts and make this a national a drive. And I think there's a lot of potential to do that. We want to make sure the resources are there and that the leadership is there to help you know, be the wind in the sails of Francis and everyone else on this panel.
Thank you all so much. So this is a panel, I think, that we got into some of the tricky, tough shenanigans issues. But I think that you will agree that there's no better people to lead us up the mountaintop than the ones that we have represented on this panel. So I want to give a round of applause to all of them. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret.